In our story tonight, it's about 20 years since Saul and Jonathan have died. David has been king over Israel during that time. And David's been walking with the Lord all this time, but there was a weakness he had. And that weakness was women. As we know, he had more than one wife. In this chapter, we're going to see David break 3 of the 10 commandments. 1, thou shalt not covet your neighbor's wife. We're going to find he did that. The second one is, thou shalt not commit adultery. We're going to see that David did that also. But you know, adultery is more than just the act. In Matthew 5, verses 27 through 28, it says, ye have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say unto you, that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her, hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. Now let me say this. You know, God made man. God made us this way. He made us to get excited when we see a woman's body. But also, at the same time, God made it that there would be only one body we would see, and that's our wife. But today, we have women who dress so skimpy. I mean, Christian men have to turn their heads. You know, we shouldn't have to wear binders on at church. But we do, again, because of some of the way the women dress. We need pastors who will preach on this. You know, the Pentecostal women, they dress like Christian women. Now, just because they dress that way, that doesn't mean they're Christians. But they do dress the way Christian women should dress. Completely clothed. They're not showing anything. There's really nothing to lust after. We can look at her beauty on the face, but the lust, it's not there because they're covered up, and that's the way it should be. And then the third one, thou shalt not murder, which we're going to see that David did this also. We're going to start at 2 Samuel chapter 11. And it came to pass, after the year was expired, at the time when the kings go forth to battle, that David sent Joab and his servants with him, and all Israel. And they destroyed the children of Ammon, and besieged Ramah, but David tarried still at Jerusalem. Every time that Israel went to battle, David their king would go with them. David is about 50 years old here, and he's still looked upon as a mighty warrior. But he didn't go into this battle. In verse 2, and it came to pass in the evening tide that David arose from off his bed and walked upon the roof of the king's house. And from the roof he saw a woman washing herself, and the woman was very beautiful to look upon. David sees her bathing, and the sight of her naked body got him excited. Just like I said, that's the way the Lord made us. But this wasn't his wife. The first look will always be there. Temptation will be there. But it says she was very beautiful to look upon, meaning he continued to look. That was David's first mistake. He continued to look, which that means he started to lust. Verse 3, and David sent and inquired after the woman, and one said, is not this Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite? And David sent messengers and took her, and she came unto him, and he laid with her, for she was purified from her uncleanness, and she returned unto her house. Now David's second mistake was he acted upon his lust, upon his temptation, and he sent for her. And then the third mistake, he had sex with her. He fell to the temptation. David did the 3 things God said not to do. This is what happened to David. This is what Psalms 1:1 is speaking about. It says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. So what the Lord is saying here, first, you're just walking. You're being entertained. You're looking. Second, you stand. You stop. And you start taking interest at what's at hand. And then third, you sit. And that's when the fall begins. We know that the Bible teaches a little bit of sin will always grow. When we do these three things, we're showing how foolish we are. Psalms 6:32. But whosoever committeth adultery with a woman lacketh understanding. He that doeth it destroyeth his own soul. Destroyeth his own soul does not mean he loses his salvation. He has lost his testimony, his witness for the Lord. And I'm going to use Jimmy Swaggart as this. I used to listen to Jimmy Swaggart all the time. I really loved his preaching. But then he had a fall. He had a fall from a woman. And it destroyed his ministry. Now, I believe slowly he's coming back. But it did destroy his ministry. And that's what this is talking about. It would destroy his own soul. Not salvation. Remember that. It's not speaking about salvation here. When we are walking with the Lord, we will honor Him in respect. We will obey His words. And we will exercise spiritual discernment. I have a teaching on that. Spiritual discernment, we need that. In Isaiah 33, verse 15, those who are honest and fair, who refuse to profit from fraud, who stay far away from bribes, who refuse to listen to those who plot murder, who shut their eyes to all enticement to do wrong. David didn't shut his eyes here. Also in Job 31, verse 1, Job says, I made a covenant with my eyes. Why then should I think upon a maid? We need to talk to our eyes. Job told his eyes, we are not looking. We need to make an agreement with our eyes that we're not going to look. And I'm speaking mainly to men here. Even though women do the same thing. Not as bad as men. Everybody knows that. Men are very physical. Where women, you know, to attract a woman is an emotional thing. But some women, the same as men, they look. So this is what got David in trouble. He didn't shut his eyes. He didn't make an agreement with his eyes. But also we're going to see that she didn't refuse him. Because the scriptures did say that David was a good-looking man. 1 Samuel 16, verse 12. So Jesse, this is David's father, so Jesse sent for him. He was dark and handsome with beautiful eyes. So Bathsheba wasn't innocent here. She also fell to temptation. The Lord says, sin is sin, but this sin is against God's temple. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 17 through 20, I'm going to read in the Living Bible. If you give yourself to the Lord, you and Christ are joined together as one person. This is why I say to run from sex sin. No other sin affects the body as this one does. When you sin this sin, it is against your own body. And haven't you yet learned that your body is the home of the Holy Spirit God gave you, and that He lives within you? Your own body does not belong to you, for God has bought you with a great price. So use every part of your body to give glory back to God, because He owns it. That's a pretty strong scripture. When we do commit adultery against it's against the temple, which our bodies is the temple of God, just like it just said. We need to meditate on that verse. So on her part and his, they let their physical eyes sin against God. And she wasn't raped. She was not raped, remember. She gave in to the temptation also. This verse also shows that Bathsheba was clearly not pregnant when she came to David, since she had just been purified from her uncleanness, it says. She just had her period. It shows that the baby was David's and not her husband's. People who are rich like David, who had everything, they have everything they want. It's still not enough. So having material things will not bring total happiness. Only the Lord can do that. He even had a couple of wives, and that still didn't satisfy him. We need to look at Moses. Moses could have had everything he wanted. He was right under the king in Egypt. He could have had all the the glories of richness. But what did he choose? He chose what Hebrews 11:25 says, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. The pleasures of sin are just temporary. And that's what people are living for. They're living for this temporary pleasures. We Christians, born again Christians, we live for that eternal pleasure. The one we're going to get when we go to heaven to be with the Father. And that's forever. That's not temporary. That's forever. Amen. Verse 5. And the woman conceived and sent and told David and said, I am with child. A little time went by, and they believed they got away with their adultery. But what happened? Their sin is revealed. She has a child. Sometimes we think we get away with whatever sin we've committed, but it comes back. It comes back to us. David has a plan on how to get out of this mess he's gotten into. In verse 6, and David sent to Joab, saying, send me Uriah the Hittite. And Joab sent Uriah to David. And when Uriah was come unto him, David demanded of him how Joab did, and how the people did, and how the war prospered. David sends for Uriah, just like he sent for Bathsheba. In both cases, David ends up sinning. He knew what he was going to do both times. What he should have done is what it says in 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 22. Abstain from all appearance of evil. A Christian should completely avoid any actions of evil. David didn't do this. Both times, sinning for these two, Bathsheba and Uriah, got him in trouble. David is lifting up Uriah. Let him think that he's a very important man. And in verse 8, and David said to Uriah, go down to thy house and wash thy feet. And Uriah departed out of the king's house, and there followed him a mess of meat from the king. Now David's telling him to go home, clean up, and he even sent food with him. And this put him in a good mood. And he hasn't seen his wife for a while. So David thinks, well, going home in a good mood, he should be ready to lay with his wife. I'm sure David is feeling better, thinking he's taking care of the problem. Because if he lays with his wife, she's already pregnant. But he would think it was his. And David would be out of this mess. Verse 9. But Uriah slept at the door of the king's house with all the servants of his lord, and went not down to his house. And when they had told David, saying, Uriah went not down into his house, David said unto Uriah, camest thou not from thy journey? Why then didst thou not go down unto thy house? David is confronting Uriah and says, man, you're away from home in battle. Why didn't you go home to be with your wife? This is the translation. Verse 11, and Uriah said unto David, the ark and Israel and Judah abide in tents, and my lord Joab and the servants of my lord are encamped in the open fields. Shall I then go into my house to eat and to drink and to lie with my wife? As thou livest, and as thou so livest, I will not do this thing. Uriah has shown how loyal he is to serving his king. He comes first, even over his family. David didn't expect such loyalty. He expected that he would go home and lay with his wife. In verse 12, and David said unto Uriah, tarry here today also, and tomorrow I will let thee depart. So Uriah abode in Jerusalem that day and the morrow. And when David had called him, he did eat and drink before him, and he made him drunk. And at even he went out to lay on his bed with the servants of the Lord, but went not down to his house. David's plans are not working, so he thinks of another plan. Let me get him drunk. For sure he'll go home with his wife. But he didn't. You know, you don't go to hell for getting drunk you don't go to hell for adultery. You go to hell for not accepting the Lord as your Savior. Now, if you continue in these things, then you have to ask yourself, am I really born again? You know, we don't want to stop when we give our life to the Lord, but we want to live for the Lord. So when we give our life, our heart to the Lord says, I want 100% of it. And that's what we do. We give Him 100%, and this stuff that is evil that we like to do, the Lord gives us the strength to do away with it, to repent from it, with the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, I don't want to make light of this. Christians, be ready. Be ready to pay the cost when you're in sin. This plan had failed, so he came up with another. And in verse 14, it says, and it came to pass in the morning that David wrote a letter to Joab and sent him by the hand of Uriah. And he wrote in the letter saying, set ye Uriah in the forefront of the hottest battle, and retire ye from him, that he may be smitten and die. This is what you call cold-blooded murder. David sent him to battle to die. Now this is coming from a man of God. So don't ever think that you are not able to commit any kind of sin like this. It's only by the grace of God we don't commit sins that others, we look at others and we think, oh, I could never do that. Don't ever think that. Here is a man of God, a Christian man, a man after God's own heart, and look what he did. So we should not ever think that we can't do those kind of sins, that we're too good or whatever. Because we're capable, believe me, we are very capable. The Lord said in Genesis 8:21, for the imaginations of the man's heart is evil from a young age. That's the way our heart is until we give it to the Lord. I mean, you look at babies. I mean, the two most popular words they say when they start speaking is mine or no. So our hearts are evil from babes on up until we accept Jesus. That's the way our heart is. Verse 16. And it came to pass when Joab observed the city that he assigned Uriah onto a place where he knew that valiant men were. And the men of the city went out and fought with Joab, and there fell some of the people of the servants of David, and Uriah the Hittite died also. Now verse 11 shows us how loyal Uriah is to the Lord, to the king, and to his people, a true man of God. Now what do some preachers do with this verse when they preach nothing but prosperity for Christians who walk with the Lord? Here we have Uriah who walked with the Lord, who was a loyal servant to David, and look what happened to him. Did he have prosperity? Look at John the Baptist. He ate locusts, and he was one of the most godliest men in the Bible. The reason they preach that way, prosperity for Christians, that's what we should expect, is because they're in it for the money. They do it for the money. People love to hear this stuff. And when they love to hear something, they're going to support you. So these men, these preachers, they need to fear God. Because He knows their heart and He knows why they're in it. Now David, a wicked king, a wicked Christian king, he lives, and a man that's walking with the Lord, Uriah, dies. Now what's wrong with this picture? Now listen to me. Where did Uriah go when he died? He went to heaven, which at that time it was called paradise. So death for a Christian is a good thing. And when we, the people, friends, family, we're going to miss them. But for the person who died, they're with the Lord now. So it wasn't really that bad that Uriah died. David is the one who's still here. David is the one who still has to live in this garbage of a world that we have. And also, we're going to see that David's going to pay dearly for his sins. For 20 years, he's going to pay dearly for those sins. Now, who wants to live to be an old age anyway? Why hurt and you can't do anything when we can be in heaven with a perfect body living in glory with God? Now, I don't say these things so we can go and commit suicide because we want to be in heaven. Our time will come soon enough. Or Jesus will come, one of the two. But it's coming. Have patience. In James 1, verses 14 and 15, it says, "But every man is tempted when he is drawn away from his own lust and enticed." Now every one of us is tempted, it says. And it says, "And we can be carried away in our own lust. And this temptation is not from God." Verse 13, right above it, it says, "Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man." So we can't say it's from God. And we can't say that the devil made us do it. Because when you're a believer, the devil can't make you do anything. The devil can't come in you, and he can't make you do anything. If we fall to the temptations, to his temptations to us, it's because we allowed it to happen. Now this chapter is for Christians. If you read verse 1, it's for Christians. Now verse 15, "Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death." Now there's two kinds of death in the Bible. Your body and soul separated from God, which is eternal death, being away from the Lord. The second is a physical death, which comes from sinning against God by disobeying Him, which 1 John 5:16 says, speaking to a brother in this verse, it says, "There is a sin unto death." Now, I'll give you an example. 1 Corinthians 11:30. It says, "Not being worthy of taking the Lord's Supper," it says, "for this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep." That sleep means death. When we the Lord's Supper is very, very serious. And right here it says in Corinthians, if you take it unworthy, if you're not walking with the Lord and you have sin in your life, we're all sinners, don't get me wrong. But if we're living in a sin and we're not repenting of it, then and we take the Lord's Supper, right here it says it, "For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep." We need to take sin in our lives very seriously. In fact, the Bible says we should hate sin. Let me say this. Obedience is not always easy, but at the end, it is the best move we'll ever make. Obeying the Lord, obeying the scriptures. Sometimes we have a hard time with it. Now, let me say this, walking in the Spirit, being filled with the Spirit, it does make it easier because you're doing it to please God. I hope you understand what I'm saying. Now, David just didn't kill Uriah. It says, "And there fell some of the people of the servants of David." So not only did he murder David, but other men fell by that sin also. So we have sin in our life. Sometimes our sin just affects us personally. But sometimes we commit sins that affect other people. And we got to remember that. David became so wicked. It doesn't say anything about him mourning over his most loyal men. Doesn't say anything about that. He is so far away from God right now. It's like he doesn't have a heart. Now, from verses 18 to 25, David makes it look all innocent. So Bathsheba doesn't find out what he did. Now we go to verse 26. And it says, "And when the wife of Uriah heard that Uriah, her husband, was dead, she mourned for her husband." Now how do you think Bathsheba feels right now? She has sinned against her husband. And now he is dead. Think about it. Make sure that when you're sinning, you're ready to handle whatever comes your way. Like I said, sin is bad. Look what happened from David's just looking. Because he looked. And look what he has come to. Verse 27. "And when the morning was past, David sent and fetched her to his house. And she became his wife, and bare him a son. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord." Now, David had to take her in to her house to become his wife to save her life. Because everyone knows that Uriah didn't go home that night. Now, back then, death was the punishment for adultery. So that's why David had to take her in, because when they saw that he had died and she was pregnant and he didn't go home, well, apparently she committed adultery because she was pregnant. So David took her in to save her life. Looks like David got away with his sin. He has Bathsheba. He has a son. Looks pretty good. But the last part of this verse says, but the thing that David had done displeased the Lord. Now, is this the kind of walk we want to have? Do we want to please ourselves and live in sin? Or do we want to please the Lord? We have a choice. If you really love the Father, this is something you don't want to do, is displease the Lord. If it doesn't affect you that you displease Him, then there's something wrong. Now, what happened to David is the reason we need to obey Psalms 1:2. Psalms 1:2 talks about how we need to meditate on the Lord day and night. Meditate on Him constantly. So when that does happen, when you take that look, you're meditating on the Lord. And when you take that look, you got it fresh in your mind because you're thinking about the Lord. You're thinking about the Scriptures and His words. More than likely, you're going to turn from lusting. Men, we have a hard time with this. Get close to the Lord. Remember, these women, I'm not saying they're non-Christians. That's why the pastor needs to preach on how women should dress. But women who are dressed that way in the church, we need to stay away from. We have to learn to meditate on them day and night. And that's what walking in the Spirit is. You're always meditating on His words. It helps us keep us strong. The Lord says, now remember, women, some women, you know, the devil leads them to us. Because when you have a beautiful woman, and maybe she's even coming on to you, Christian man, what you need to do is look on the other side of that woman, and you'll see the devil. The devil will be using her to bring you down. We got to remember that. The Lord says in James, the best way to fight Satan is to get closer to the Lord. That's what we need to do.